Well, you may have read about it. It is perhaps one of the most prolific, the richest natural resources on God's earth. And a number of powerful show business figures are making their own influence felt in an effort to save what we've come commonly to know as the Brazilian rainforest. This is what's happening to it. Let me just show you just in advance of introducing our superstar. Between 50 and 100 acres of tropical rainforest are destroyed every minute. Every minute. Every hour, 3,000 acres are destroyed. Over one quarter, incidentally, of the pharmaceuticals prescribed in the United States are derived from tropical rainforest plants. This is the richest, most diverse neighborhood of life found anywhere on planet Earth. We may have as many as 2.5 billion acres of tropical forests remaining from the original 4 billion. It will affect us, and no doubt about it, politics intervene, and against the weight of a lot of powerful groups over there, including ranchers and other people who want to use this area for more immediate marketplace purposes, we have the efforts of a lot of very powerful people, including this one. It's my pleasure to introduce one of rock's superstars, ladies and gentlemen, Sting. Nice, huh? Well, listen, what do you know? A superstar with a social conscience. Your commitment to all good things did not come yesterday. You certainly were part of Live Aid, and now you've been introduced to this controversy, which is getting more and more coverage in the free press around the world. I speak of the Brazilian rainforest, to which dilemma you were introduced by the chap next to you, Jean-Pierre Dutilleux. First, tell us...
Why?
Yeah. What were your first thoughts as you...
I just think this issue is fundamental to all other human activity. And it's about the air we breathe, it's about the water we drink and the food we eat. Without these things, there's no other human activity. There's no justice, there's no... There's no culture, there's no music, there's nothing. So this is absolutely fundamental to everyone who's watching.
Uh-huh. Did you understand its complexity when you were first introduced to
No,
this?
I didn't. I mean, I saw the destruction. We traveled from Brasilia to where Rowney lives in the jungle, and it took 4 hours on a little plane. And most of that journey was taken up by desert, this red, dusty desert with the occasional stump of a tree, the occasional head of cattle. And then you reach the rainforest, and it's beautiful. It's fantastic, green, cathedral-like, fantastic beauty. And you see this thing that what's happened to it, it's like rape. It makes you feel angry. It makes you want to do something. That activated me going there and seeing it firsthand.
Let me say that Rayani, to whom you referred a moment ago, is with us. You are chief of the Magnatis tribe of the Kayopo group of Indians in the southern Amazon basin. You do not speak English. And I am obliged to tell our viewers that the plate inside your distended lower lip is intended to frighten enemies. This is quite obviously a very important cultural identity, tribal identity for you, and signifies that, among other things, you are no warrior, but you're not going to run from a fight either. Do I have this in rather flippant translation? Is reasonably close, am I? Jean-Pierre.
Yes, this is fine. Rowney is a man of peace. He's united the tribes. He's told the tribe to stop fighting, And he's the man that has this dream that we are trying to help. So we bring you a little bit of good news. We want to do this. We want to create a park that's as big as Great Britain.
Show him again. Your intention is to actually make this a biggest national park
in the world.
Will be an international park then. A national park which would be under the aegis of the Brazilian government?
Yes. We've started a foundation that's a Brazilian foundation. This is a Brazilian initiative. It's not foreigners going to Brazil and telling them what to do.
Uh-huh. How do you get out from under the possibility that the great white man from the West is from Europe, if not North America, is dropping out of the sky to tell these local people what's good for them?
That's not true. You know, this idea came from Rowney. We visited him 2 years ago, and he told me the story of the forest. He told me what was happening to his people. I'd seen for myself, and he asked me a very direct question. He said, "Sting, I want you to help me." And I said, "Look, I'm a singer. What can I do?" He says, "No, people listen to you. People have told me you sing to a lot of people, and so you have to help me." What do you say? And I said, "Okay." So well, here we are.
Presidential candidates have discovered the power of rock musicians in the past. We should welcome your participation in this very important ecological effort. Let me end. Did you want to make a point?
No, I think he wants to say a few words.
Please. Ronnie, should
Ronnie
speak.
Vai.
Eu vou parar porque eu vi que tem tanta fumaça, tanta rio tão chuva, pessoas tão estragar no rio.
I want to tell you a few words. You know, I'm so concerned because there's so much smoke over the Amazon because of the fires. All the rivers are polluted.
Será que o branco vai acabar esse mato?
Is it that the white man will destroy all the forest?
Será que o branco não pensa?
Is it that the white man can't think?
Você tem que pensar.
You have to think.
Você tem que lembrar.
You have to remember.
Palavra de mim.
My words.
Vamos deixar onde tem mato, onde tem rio.
Let's leave the forest alone. Let's leave the rivers alone.
Ano passado tem muito fumaça.
Last year there was so much smoke.
Minha preocupação é isso.
This is my concern.
Então a gente tem que lembrar, pensar, nós vamos deixar onde tem mato para nosso filho, nosso neto.
We have to leave this jungle alone for our children and our grandchildren.
Tom Lovejoy is here to make us smart. You're an Assistant Secretary for External Affairs of the Smithsonian Institution. You're a tropical biologist and expert on the rainforest. Tell me about this contribution that this particular jewel of the planet Earth makes toward our global ecology. Explain this to me. Why should we care? And what happened? Tell me about CO2, for example.
Well, let me start with something else, if I may. You're talking about the greatest single stock of genetic resources on the planet, like 30% of all different kinds of plants and animals. Talking about the greatest expression of life on Earth, and links to regional climate, because this forest makes half its own rainfall. And it's also got a lot of carbon in it, so when it's destroyed, like you were hearing described, and you have a cloud of a million square kilometers of smoke over the Amazon last summer, you're adding to the greenhouse effect, which, as you know, everybody's begun to worry about.
And the prime mover in the destruction of the forest are, is it fair to say, people interested in ranching?
There are a lot of ranchers driven by government subsidies and incentives, and then a lot of small colonists who pour in there thinking they got a great future, which they don't.
And pretty much disregard the people who live and call this area their home.
And that's the ultimate tragedy, is what happens to the indigenous peoples.
Right. Now, tell me about the political at the highest levels. What would you expect our government to do, and what is our government doing, and how much correspondence and social engagement do we have with the people who manage Brazil?
Well, it's a complicated question, as you can imagine, and there's very little we can do telling Brazil to do something. But what we can do is figure out ways to help them, ways to finance them, give them technical support, on things of that sort.
Right.
And then a lot of informal diplomacy.
Right. Those who are interested in those people who are benefiting from knocking those trees down, from sawing those trees down, might chuckle or at least raise an eyebrow at the rather pompous way that Americans, for example, wade into this controversy when they look at Prince William Sound off Valdez, Alaska. When they look at one of our most powerful cities, Los Angeles, California, where you cannot even see on some days the mountains, not to mention the ocean. So who are we to presume this kind of instruction for another country?
Well, I think you have to look at it the following way. I mean, this is a planet in serious trouble. We've got less than 10 years to sort of turn around these terrible trends, and there's not a single country that's a white hat in this game. And we all have to go into it and try and figure out how we can help each other to solve these big problems.
Did you want to add to that, Sting?
I think it's important for us to realize that there's a reason why these poor people leave the cities of Brazil to go into the rainforest, because I've been there. It's no easy life. It's hell. It's a green hell. The insects bite you. It's incredibly hot. They go there because they're desperate. And they go there because they can't support their families. They have no land, they have no wages, they have no way of feeding the kids, and if I was a poor Brazilian, I'd be in the rainforest chopping it down as well, and so would everybody in this room. The reason this happens is because Brazil's economy is enslaved to our banks. They have to pay all the profit they make back to our banks
right.
in interest.
How do you feel about a proposal that would swap nature for debt credits?
Well, I think that works in a lot of countries, but not in Brazil. The Brazilians are as proud as Americans are that this is their country. If they had an ecological problem in Montana, no one here would thank Brazilians coming to Montana and saying, let's own this piece of land. That is Brazil. It's a Brazilian problem. They have to solve it, but we can help them.
And I assume that Rayoni and Magaran, people who live in this region, I want to exploit the rainforest in a way that will ensure its survival and at the same time ensure the immediate survival of these proud men and their families.
Well, they've lived this way for centuries, you know, and if left alone, they will carry on living that way. They're the only people who can sustainably use the forest.
By what, rubber tapping?
No, but by hunting the animals, by using the forest and not chopping it down.
There's no currency in the Amazon. I mean, when you live amongst the Indians, there's no police, there's no taxes, no pollution, there's no money. Brownie doesn't want to sell the land for the gold, or doesn't want to sell the timber or anything. He just wants to leave it the way it is. They want to continue to live the way they've always lived.
Uh-huh.
Now, Phil, can we go back to this debt for nature stuff?
Sure.
The president of Venezuela told me about 4 weeks ago, he said he thought debt for nature was a good idea, it just hadn't been presented well.
He thought debt for nature?
Yeah.
Meaning what?
Meaning, you know, you can go out and buy debt. It's like almost like a bond or a stock. It's a piece of paper worth something. And a lot of companies buy this stuff and go down and build factories in Brazil or Mexico.
We'll reduce your debt if you let us use this.
No, not quite like that, because that's sort of like, you know, twisting their arm. It's taking that piece of paper and going to a Brazilian organization that does conservation and saying, here, this is yours. You go to the central bank and get the local currency, and then you can do whatever needs to be done. And I think it will happen in Brazil. We just need to figure out how to go at it in a way that's not frightening.
Mm-hmm. Does it bother you that we have to use someone with the power and influence of Sting to get on television in the daytime in America? Do you have any idea the chances of a talk show speaking to this issue, given the realities of our competitive game right now? Well, and how does that make you feel?
Well, we've been struggling for this for over 20 years. I myself have been trying to do this for 16 years. And this is the way it works today. Someone like Sting, who is a sensible and intelligent person, can bring this issue so that we can be here today. We have been traveling all over the world. This is the 12 countries we've done in 3 weeks. And we just hope that after this show, people aren't just going to move and do something else, because the problem is not going to go away.
Yes.
I just wanted to say that, first of all, I admire Sting. I have for quite some time. I'm really in awe of the things that you've tried to do for so many people over such a long period of time through Amnesty International and this. I was just wondering what we could do ourselves. I mean, we're far away from the tropical rainforest. What could we do to help?
Well, we're not that far away. I think, as this man says, you know, this area controls our climate, controls our ability to grow food. I think we have to realize it's our problem because we're part of the problem, so we have to be part of the solution. First of all, I'd like everyone to send a little money to the Rainforest Foundation. I think we have a plan that's very concrete. It's not a dream. Also, I believe everyone should realize that they're not powerless in this. But collectively, we are a consumer pressure group, and we can have pressure on the companies that are destroying the rainforest, the people who destroy the forest to make hamburgers, for example. We can stop eating hamburgers so they don't do it, or find out which companies are doing it. I think we have to realize we have power, all of us.
And you also live in a democracy, and every vote counts. And if your elected officials know that you care about this, they'll work on it.
I think it's great that what you're doing for these people, I mean, we take so much for granted. We live in like a society where we are New York City. There's no vegetation. These tribes people are living, their life is the vegetation. I just want to commend you. I think it's great what you're doing.
Thank you.
Just a comment about the debt issue. Even if Brazil is not, you know, is resistant to the idea of us being able to just sort of buy their land for forgiving debt. I mean, Brazil has over $100 billion debt. Simply working on forgiving or reducing that debt would take some of the pressure off using the rainforest to produce cash. I mean, why? They cut down the trees to sell wood to Japan. They cut down the trees to make, you know, ranches to sell beef to the United States. And just forgiving some of that debt would take away the reason, or at least the excuse,
yes,
for some of that.
The problem is the manner in which the debt would be reduced, and would there be middlemen involved in these transactions? And if they are, what is their piece, and what piece finally extends to the native citizens of the area who have, for all these years, been exploited by middlemen who are doing the bidding for some very, very high-powered commercial interests who have no particular allegiance to the local area?
Let me address that, if I may. Before I went to the Smithsonian, I worked for the World Wildlife Fund for 14 years and ran their program. And you know, that has involved millions and millions and millions over the years. And it's just like any other intelligent thing you try and do. You go and look for the best partners in the country who will do the job very responsibly. I think it can be done.
I want to know how Sting balances his career and fighting the Amazon in his schedule. Are you going to give up singing?
Well, I haven't sung all year. I've been in the jungle most of this year. I can't say I regret it. I think it's an issue that is fundamental to me. I want to give my kids a good answer in 10 years when they say, "Dad, what did you do to save the rainforest?" I want to be able to say I tried something, even if it's so small.
You are the oldest of four children.
Yes, sir.
Your father was a very good singer himself, I'm told.
He was a very good singer, yeah.
Was he a milkman?
He delivered the milk every day.
In a place, how far from London?
It's about 300 miles north of London, almost in Scotland.
Mm-hmm. So you're a country boy then, are you? Or village boy, shall we say?
It's like Detroit, actually.
Detroit. Well, it's not Manchester.
No, it's not Manchester.
What is the name of the town?
It's called Newcastle.
Newcastle.
Mm-hmm. No Newcastle.
Uh-huh. The place to which we do not take colds.
That's exactly the place.
You taught school, did you?
I was a school teacher, and then I left and went to London to become a professional musician.
Your mother was a music devotee.
My mother was a great piano player.
She liked Buddy Holly, didn't she?
She did. She brought the first rock and roll records into the house. Buddy Holly, Little Richard, people like that. 78, so big ones.
So you really had a groovy mother then, as we might say.
She was groovy to the last, I have to tell you.
Uh-huh. She lives, does she?
No, they both passed away.
Did they see their beloved son, Gordon, succeed to the extent?
They did. Mm-hmm.
They saw the big stadium?
They had Grammy Awards on the mantelpiece and platinum records. They were proud.
And your social conscience was, I assume, considerably shaped by your childhood experience.
I'm from a poor family, and we lived in a working class area. But I got a good education, and it allowed me access to another world, a different world. But I never forgot my roots, and I still haven't.
Uh-huh. And so this is an actual, then, for you, a political timeout. Is that how we want to say this?
Perhaps. I'm not and sure I understand that expression, timeout.
You've been to Brazil
a number of times. I've toured there a lot. I'm very well known in Brazil. 2 years ago, I went to the rainforest for the first time, and I've been going back since. It's kind of addictive. It's so beautiful, and it's so so exciting. Things happen to you. We got attacked by snakes, by giant tarantulas.
Yeah.
It's an incredible place.
Do you feel any danger at all, or do you feel the seriousness of this political drama that's underway regarding this natural resource?
Well, it's a place of wonder, it's a place of magic, but it's also a place of extreme danger. People get murdered a lot. I saw a picture of a young boy, 8 years old, full of bullets, the other day, a young Indian boy, killed by miners.
Less than 2 years ago at the Waldorf Astoria, I will take just a moment to tell you, Vladimir Posner, a Soviet, and myself were honored by the Better World Society. And one of our co-honorees was Chico Mendez, who stood up to thank very humbly those who rewarded him. He came all the way to the Waldorf to get, because this guy has been in the trenches trying to save his people and the forest too. And last December, he was shot dead in his backyard, I think. His own backyard.
This man was a great hero who spent most of his life without any publicity saving acres and acres of rainforest, just like Rowney.
So quite obviously there are tremendously powerful commercial interests in collision here.
Well, money talks in Brazil. And the problem is it's easy money. It's money, you chop the forest down tomorrow and there's a bit more. But sooner or later that resource is going to be gone and there's nothing left. It doesn't make good sense to me.
And we'll be back in just a moment.
What the bomb?
Loose talk in the classroom. Two words they try and try. Strong words in the staff room. The accusations fly. It's no use. He sees her. He starts to shake. He starts to cry. Just like the old man. Parents put by.
That is Tokyo. The man works for a living.
I was getting hot. I had to take my jacket off.
If you joined us late, we're in the company of Sting, who has formed the Rainforest Foundation, which hopes to turn 600 square miles of Amazon jungle into a national park. This effort is headed up by Jean-Pierre Dudieu, who is, I hope, French. If you're not, we're...
Belgian.
All right. I should have known. Rayoni joins us as well, a non-English speaker who is here as a citizen, a man whose heritage traces to and continues to flourish in the Brazilian rainforest, a very, very a vast part of our earth, we should say. Magarin is also here. You are a Caiope Indian chief of the Amazon River Basin. Tom Lovejoy, you've also met as Assistant Secretary of External Affairs for the Smithsonian. He's a tropical biologist, and he's saying, if this forest goes, so goes the whole neighborhood, and they are also saying the neighborhood is going. Didn't the astronauts see the smoke from the Challenger? You could see the legacy of the destruction of the rainforest from the orbiting Challenger vehicle. Yes, ma'am.
I'm from a part of the country that's predominantly farmland, and I'm wondering if I have a lot of empathy for that for the farming situation, and I'm wondering if people are becoming saturated with so many different types of causes. We've had Live Aid and Band-Aid and Farm Aid, and I'm wondering if you're feeling that, yes, if people are becoming very saturated with that.
You know, I think I said it before, this is fundamental to everything. If we can't breathe and we can't grow food and we can't drink the water, what can we do? I think it's we really have to tackle this problem. You know, we're at war, and we have to win this battle, or it could be the last. I'm serious about that.
You embark upon this mission this point will be made and then I move on. In a culture that is not teaching its children biology. We don't know from chloroform nothing. Darwin gets a page and a half. If you don't understand why it's important, it's awful hard. It's difficult to engender political passion. And we've already been scolded by our own government commission who told us we aren't doing well. Sir.
Eu vou falar pouco ainda com você.
I'm going to speak a little more to you.
Você não pode ficar preocupado com nosso trabalho.
Don't worry about our work.
Eu sei que o Espírito meu está acompanhando nosso trabalho.
I know that my Spirit is accompanying us, is protecting us on this work.
Meu Espírito mais forte.
My Spirit is the strongest one.
Meu Espírito estava fazendo junto com nós a campanha ou progresso do demarcação da terra.
This Spirit is with us on this campaign and he's helping us to get this land demarcated.
I want to say that those who joined us late are entitled to have me explain that the plate inside your distended lower lip is intended to frighten your enemies and signifies that you are a warrior. It is a cultural feature of your own tribe, which we respect and are pleased to explain here in the States. Hello.
Hello. This is obviously a multi-tiered problem of global proportions. Have you called on an international body like the UN for help?
No, we haven't. I mean, we've been on tour for 4 weeks now. We've met with President Mitterrand of France, met with the Pope the other day. We met with Prince Charles of England, Juan Carlos, the King of Spain, the President of Spain. But really, my interest has been in reaching ordinary people, taxi drivers, housewives. You know, whatever you do, you have to realize it's your problem. I think the governments will only listen to us when we have one voice and say, let's do something. And that's up to everyone watching, everyone in this room. We're all involved.
Yeah.
Sting, I'd like to know how you adjust to lifestyle over there. What do you eat when you're in the rainforest, and do you understand the language?
Well, I've had macaco, which is monkey, which tastes a bit like bad duck. I've had piranha, which tastes good too. We eat snake, and manioc.
Did you bring off,
I'm sorry?
Did you bring off insect repellent?
The insects laugh at that stuff. They love it. They see,
really?
They see a white man come to the jungle and they think it's a feast day and they go for you.
I wanted to know if any of the land that has been cleared is reclaimable at all.
No.
Why?
The rainforest is built on a very thin layer of topsoil. And when you get rid of the trees, the wind blows and it goes away and it's a desert. You cannot regrow the rainforest. It's taken thousands of years to grow. You can never have it back.
And you should remember that all those species that go extinct as the rainforest is destroyed, you can never bring those back again either.
We should make this point. There are millions and millions of species which thrive in the rainforest because of its unique crucible for the promotion of life, including all those creepy, crawly things about which Charles Darwin revealed so much. This is no small consideration. This is not just the loss. These are not just the losses of beetles and bugs and creepy crawlies. These are the sources of a lot of medicines. Certainly that's true with the vegetation. And I think my notes suggest that something like 100 species are becoming extinct of these particular entomological categories every day. So?
That's true. I mean, you know, the important thing to remember here is that we vertebrates are really just along for the ride in the world, and that it's the plants and the wigglies and the squirmies that run the place.
Okay, Sting, you mentioned that you had a concrete plan for saving the rainforest. What is this plan, and how is it feasible on a long-term basis?
Well, it's a micro solution to a macro problem. In other words, the rainforest is enormous. By comparison, our park is quite small, but it is the size of my own country, Great Britain. We feel if we can create a model that works to protect the Indians, to protect the wildlife, to protect the rivers and the trees, and also can be seen as economically viable. In other words, we can use the forest for rubber tapping, for picking fruit. Then that model can be repeated elsewhere. We feel it's impossible to say, let's save the whole rainforest. We're saying, let's start here and let's build from there.
So there's a lot of industry or commerce that involves extraction, not destruction.
It's been proved economically that ranching is a disaster and you make much more money by picking fruit.
What has the Brazilian government done, and who exactly is responsible for the destruction that's been taking place?
Is that coming to me?
Oh, well, please don't duck it. This is the second time it's come up. You'll proceed with dispatch.
Okay, you got like a million colonists poured into the Western Amazon in the last 5 years. You have major ranching exercises going on. And all of those are very destructive as compared to the more traditional ways of using the forest, like taking Brazil nuts out. I mean, like 50,000 tons of Brazil nuts are harvested out of the forest every year. And if you really do a study, it turns out that you make more money out of an acre of land treating it that way than any of those destructive approaches.
Isn't imperialism evident, though? How can Brazil, with this magnificent natural resource, possibly have a debt problem? It can only have a debt problem if somebody is stealing something from someone else. Saudi Arabia doesn't have a debt problem because they've got oil. Why should the Brazilians have a debt problem?
A worse debt problem than Brazil? The United States of America. Yeah. The United States owns the world currency, the dollar, but we owe $1 trillion. I don't know how much that is. It sounds like an awful lot of money, but that is why interest rates are so high, and that is why the Brazilians can't pay their debt back, because we're in debt. Why are we in debt? We're supposed to be the richest country in the world.
I have a brilliant answer to that question. But I see the clock will not permit me to offer it to you. And we'll be back in just a moment. Kenny Kirkland is on keyboard and Tracy Wormworth is bass. Sting is about to offer us a song titled Fragile, which you will sing in the language of Brazil, Portuguese. If you please, sir.
Amanhã a chuva levará o sangue que a luta deixou derramar na beia do aço tão cruel. Jamais a nossa voz vai calar. O mato assim pode acabar como uma vida e nada mais. Porque nem mesmo a violência destrói ideais. Tem gente que nos enche e o mundo assim ficará frágil demais. Choro eu e você. Thank you.
We should ask, Sting, why don't you take your seat here? Give us a brief translation of these lyrics.
I'll give you the whole translation, take a long time. It's basically about how fragile we are, how fragile the human body is, and also how fragile the planet is.
I think Sting made a good point before. He said one of the ways we could help was to protest by not eating the hamburgers. But unfortunately, the majority of the population doesn't realize the seriousness of the problem and probably wouldn't realize it until there was no cattle to grow, no cattle to produce these hamburgers. I think people really need to realize that it is a problem, and we these common people, have to do something to help.
You know, it takes more land to feed one cat, one head of cattle, than does to feed a human being. They're eating the planet.
Yes.
I think that cultural work, like the work you're doing, and perhaps Indians can make some of the changes for music and art and so forth. Where is Brazil's place in this? Would it be appropriate maybe in the future to get Gobim or some of the Brazilian stars, musical stars, to gather together to?
You know, all the Brazilians I know, and I know a lot, particularly the musicians, utterly concerned about their rainforest. They want to protect it as much as anyone. And we have to encourage that. We really do.
I was wondering, is the national park going to be enough to help the situation?
No, no way is it enough. This is just the beginning. We have to save the whole thing.
Anyway, what you were saying about biology, we're not teaching our children biology. Yeah. Okay, I feel you're wrong about that. They could save the rainforest by the people in Brazil teaching their children not to go in there and rip down the forest to raise cattle, but to preserve it and look for another means of economic income. And we can do the same thing here.
But I think if you're ignorant, you're not moved. You can't be moved if you're ignorant. In other words, what's it? I'm afraid that we're really not going to get scared until the greenhouse really does, and we suddenly respiratory and people start dropping. We're going to say, hey, how'd this happen?
So they don't know what they're doing by going in and destroying this rainforest. They're not aware of it. They should be made aware of it more than us.
You know, most environmental problems in the world are made up of individual decisions which seem perfectly reasonable in their own right. So there just needs to be a big public education effort everywhere and creation of alternatives for those people.
My concern is about the people that live there now. What's going on for them? What are their lives like and their children's lives?
Well, you know, there were about 2 million Indians at the turn of the century in Brazil. There are now less than 150,000. They have been decimated by diseases. When I met Rowney many, many years ago, he had just lost 4 of his children to a flu epidemic, and his mother and his father. Entire villages, entire nations, entire cultures have vanished from the surface of the earth.
So now this last Indians, and Rowney is their chief, are trying this last stand. And this is why we're here today. And we're trying to support them. We hope that what's happening here today is not going to be a repeat story of what happened here 100 years ago.
And we'll be back in just a moment.
The Rainforest Foundation is at Department 0101 in Los Angeles. The zip is 90084. I'd be glad to give you that address again if you're without a pencil. In our audience is Red Crow and Piacon, both of whom have more than just a passing interest in this issue. I assume you are not English speakers, and I welcome you and thank you. You are. I should not have been so presumptuous. I thank you for being here, and I'm sure you join us in hoping that maybe the curtain will raise a bit. We'll have more information around the world and maybe arrest the destruction of the rain.
I've traveled with him throughout Europe on this tour and expressing that we as Indian people regard everything on earth as sacred. And if we all regarded things on earth as sacred, we wouldn't destroy it.
Also with Sting in this considerable political undertaking is his partner, Trudy Styler, a woman who's with him through thin and thin, and the jungle as well, and who shares with Sting the most precious gift of all, two children. We're glad you're here. Someday I'll have 3 hours, but it's not today. What would be the one brief thing you'd like to share?
Well, I'd just like to say to all the mothers in the room, and to, I know you have a lot of mothers who are listening this afternoon, that I do urge you and ask you to lobby your congressmen, to lobby your schools, to have this problem introduced into schools so that your children will learn about it. Thank you.
It's a good cause, but how much is the United States actually using for pharmaceuticals towards these species of 30,000 species of plants? And how come you're not taking advantage of this, say other countries are, of the United States?
55% of all products you find in pharmacies in the United States come from products derived from the rainforest.
Mostly vegetation, as in aloe, medicinal plants, and all those other magnificent, wonderful vegetables.
Yeah, there are so many remedies and to so many diseases in the rainforest. For instance, that those old Indians, the old shamans there, they have knowledge of herbs and plants. And these men are just dying one after the other, and with them a library of knowledge. And one of the things our foundation would like to do is to try and meet with these people and gather this information so it's not gone. We can all.
I just want to make a comment. My husband farms 1,200 acres in central Jersey, and he is very concerned about the greenhouse problem, and that we think what you're doing is great.
Thank you.
What is the rest of South America doing this problem?
What is Brazil and the rest of South America?
Well, you know, that they're in terrible trouble. They have an enormous number of poor people, and they have no money. We have to help them. You know, we have to make the rate by which they repay their debt back a little more flexible. The rules have to be softened a little. Otherwise, they'll never be out of debt, and this forest will keep burning. Yes. It's up to us.
Sting made the point earlier that the park is just a small thing. Who is opposing the park? Where is the opposition coming from, the establishment of this one national park?
I think it's time. The rainy season is just about to end. The trees dry, and that all it takes is a match to burn acres. It takes five minutes.
But he wants to know who would oppose such a wonderful idea.
There's a lot of, so much wealth under the ground, and in the ground there's timber, there's gold, there's uranium.
So don't exclude us from looking for what is under the ground as well as what's growing on top of it.
About the ethnocide and the cultural genocide that's going on down there, what is the world courts are doing? Because what happened in the United States and the rest of the indigenous world seems to be happening down there, and all of us are brothers and sisters of all four colors, and we should learn to live together, love ourselves, and love this earth that we are in.
And we'll be back in just a moment.
Transcript of today's show, send $3 to Donahue Transcripts, 267 Broadway, New York, New York, 1007, or call 212-227-READ.
Oh, I was going to ask, in our country, in the Pacific Northwest, for every tree that's cut down by the lumber companies, another one has to be planted. Is there any way that something like this can be... some program such as this can be used in the rainforest?
I wish that was the case, you know, but in Brazil they have one hardwood tree that they go for, but they have to chop another 100 down to get to it, so they just burn it. And it's totally wasted for just for one tree. It just doesn't happen
there. I was wondering if the plate is uncomfortable, can you eat, and does anybody else have it?
Yes, she's inquiring about this, the cultural feature of his lower lip.
Yes.
Is it difficult? Is it distracting? Is it painful?
No, that's how when he's a child, they make a small incision, they make a small plane, and then at the plate, and it grows up. It does. They can eat, they can sleep, there's no problem. But quite a few of them still wear it in the tribes.
He's got his own plate when he sits down to eat anyway. But I noticed, Sting, the rock star's got the most beautiful wives, I noticed that. But I want to ask one question.
And we're almost out of time, my goodness.
Is that the only one rainforest in the world in Brazil? Aren't there any more?
No,
that's
no,
it?
It's around the world, but Brazil has 30% of it.
Yeah.
Is it the custom today that people still have the plate enlarged like that?
Yes, it is. It's for those who treasure the tradition, yes. I assume not all children have adopted this particular feature of the culture.
No.
Sting, thank you for loving the world the way you do, and we all love you.
Thank you. Maybe... can I say something?
Our Brazilian.
Services
say,
provided and promotional fees paid by the following.
Help us save 5 acres of incredible rain.
Our Brazilian friend brother said he was sure his spirit was with him on this one.